Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention, please? Good evening.
You're listening to Straight Talk with Dean and Marc. We thank you for tuning in and hope you enjoy another exciting episode of our show.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to March and another episode of Straight Talk with Dean and Marc. It's a six-man Dean Geronimo. I'm here in the studio, and from NJ to NC, I'm in here with my right-hand man, Marc Lee. So, Marc, tell me what's good in your neck of the woods, my brother.
Man, it's been a busy week. You know, I know we've got 1,001 things going on. What else is new? You know, we just got way too many things happening in our world and all of that. So we just finished doing the Black Business Olympics with Eric Kelly and had a number of motivational speakers and all of that that came in and conversated with us and definitely had some great conversations about everything from how we need to be doing better with our money, because apparently one man, Elon Musk, got more money than all of us together. And I do mean all of us together and everything. So we were talking about how we got to do better with our money and our investments, and then there was talk about faith and talk about culture and the arts and how that plays into business and a number of other things. So it was just some great, amazing conversations, some great, amazing thought leaders from around the country, and I would even argue around the world, because I know we had one guy calling from Singapore and one of the bishops called in from London. So we definitely had people calling in from around the world, and that's my second week of these conferences. So I've got a conference break today, because I know I did the one that ended on Sunday with Eric, and then I did the one the week before from the fine folks around Rockingham and Greensboro area. So now I get a break until somebody else calls and decides to tell us that they want to do a conference using StreamYard or one of the other platforms that we have access to and all of that. But I did get a chance to take a break, but I did do my other regular shows on the international broadcast media, and they were both fascinating as well. Earlier today, I had Miss Cassandra Mayo on, and she was talking about Cassandra Crawley Mayo, to be exact, but she was talking about the fact that she's written a book about retiring at 52, so she's trying to retire early, and it's trying to show other folks how they can retire early as well. And she's worked as in the corporate level, both at the hotels, like I think she was at a Courtyard Marriott, as well as some other types of big corporations as well. But right now, she's just trying to enjoy the world of retirement in terms of being in corporate America. But as she told me, she's not trying to retire from life, because she does want to still be engaged, be involved in the community, be engaged in a number of other things, but she doesn't have to go report at corporate America. And she said she has set that as a goal for herself way back when she was a youngster. So it sounds like she met her goal and is now giving advice and all of that. And then right before jumping on with you, I had Mr. Brent Sutterfield, who I met through a website called Potted that helps book different performers and guests and everything. But he is actually a man that with a DNA scientist background, but he has also claimed that he has been over to the other side and spoken to both Jesus and God. So he was sharing some of what that conversation was like and what he learned. And he was even saying that when he went up there, he saw different houses. So there wasn't like just one big heaven where, just, as we've talked about on this show, where it was all Christians and all this. He actually did see what we talked about on this show, what we envisioned. At least that's what he saw on his journey, that he said, because he saw the way he was describing it. I think he was using mansions, maybe as an analogy, maybe as an actuality, but he was like saying that he definitely saw Hindus up there, and he saw Christians, and he saw a number of other folks. So, you know, those that believe it's their way or the highway, it seems to me that he was trying to disprove them, even though I did have a guest on, actually two guests on, that were strictly Christians, and they were definitely more of the my way or the highway kind of attitude, because they were thinking, you know, it's only got to be their way, but no other way to get there. But like I said, he was did not dismiss them, but he did not say that they were wrong. He just said, as he put it, I'm just sharing you what my experience was, and I thought that was a great way for him to handle it. And definitely he gave some good insight, and even said what it was like, you know, and some of the, even seeing some of those flashback kind of things that apparently people see when they have those experiences. So he did talk about even some of the things that he saw back in his past, not in great details, but he did explore a couple of them and also shared a little bit about his own dark past, because apparently he was a suicidal teen at one point. So he talked about that. He talked about growing up in a family where he was, you know, getting chastised by his dad for getting a 98. And he's like, dang, oh, you know, most of you would be happy. But apparently his dad was like one of them, I guess, perfectionists and wanted him to get the 100. And if he did, and if he got the 100, wanted him to get the extra credit. So, like you said, he shared a little bit about that as well. So he definitely seemed like he had a heavy-headed dad, in my opinion. But that's just my opinion. So what's happening in your world, I did understand. And I was wondering, because Bill Tresvant had appeared on my, well, not mine, but on Zach's Funk Music with Zach, and he said that he thought it was going to pass, and as I was doing the interview, I did see a notice that came across that the stimulus has passed, so now we just got to wait for weeks or months to see when the check actually gets cut.
You know what? They sent some things in the mail saying, you know, you should get it soon and blah, 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 and I'm like, man, listen, we need more than that, but I'm not going to fuss too much, and we'll just take what you're giving us right now. I'm thankful to still have employment. So, you know, I take that, put it to the side, because you're probably going to take it away from me once I file my taxes anyway. So, you know, it's one of those things where it'll benefit some people, yes. And then it'll be a detriment to others. So, you kind of look at it.
Wait a minute. Are you saying it's a shell game?
Man, depending on which side of the table you're on. You know, if you make a certain amount of money, you know they're going to hit you with the taxes later on, so you go pay it back. It's like giving you a loan. I'm fronting you this money. And when you file your taxes to tell me how much money you actually made, then I'll decide if I'm going to take it back from you or not. You know, and for other people, it actually helps them, because they're actually trying to pay bills and keep food in the refrigerator or keep the lights on and keep heat on and all of those things. So it actually helps them. So, you know, like I said, can't be mad. It just depends on what side of the table you're sitting on as to whether it's a benefit or if it's in a very good help. Could it be more? Of course it could. You know, and I say that all the time with the money that's being spent in quote-unquote foreign aid, and we have a pandemic going on, and you still find a way to send those millions and millions away from us, but you still won't raise the minimum wage, talking about it's going to hurt small businesses. But you could help all of this stuff if you wanted to. You know, don't give me dirt and tell me it's cake. You could do it for the simple fact that you're giving money to others that are not here, still during the time where we needed the most. So that's just my opinion on it, man. Like sometimes I wonder what the thought process is, but when you are part of the haves, you don't have a lot of consideration for the have not. And that's a big problem that we have in this country, you know. Huge problem. One day it may change. Who knows? We'll wait. It remains to be seen. But for now, I guess it's business as usual, unfortunately. You know what I mean? Hey, bro, you there? Uh-oh. We'll be right back. Give us a few seconds. We'll be right back. All right, we're back for a second. It's the wonders of technology that hold us up sometimes. While we're waiting for Mark to come back, found an interesting article here about why sugar, cheese, and fast food are more addictive than heroin. And it says cookies could be even more addictive than heroin, a new book reveals. A study over the years has revealed the shocking power of sweetness. In one 1980 experiment, human subjects were asked to push a button as soon as they sensed the hit of sugar placed upon their tongue. The reactions were almost instantaneous. A fraction of a second after the sugar landed on their tongues, they sensed it. The smoke from cigarettes takes 10 seconds to stir the brain, but a touch of sugar on the tongue would do so in a little more than half a second. Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist Michael Moss writes in his new book, Hook Food, Free Will, and How the Food Giants Exploit Our Addiction, published by Random House, and it comes out Tuesday. That's nearly 20 times faster than cigarettes. Not only can food be as addictive as cigarettes, alcohol, and some drugs, he said, but in some way, even more so. And food manufacturers take advantage of our base instincts and biology to get us hooked on their product, Moss told the Post. While cigarettes, drugs, and hard booze rely on specific chemicals such as nicotine, morphine, and ethanol to affect the brain and get us hooked, processed foods use simpler substances to make us crave them, than the unholy trinity of salt, sugar, and fat. These tasty temptations cue our brain to release the pleasure hormone dopamine, enticing us to come back for more. When we see, smell, or merely think about chocolate cake, it's the dopamine that makes us want a slice, as much as the sugar and butter in the cake, Moss writes. This is a tool for our survival. We need to eat in order to live, and dopamine is there to motivate us to eat. Manufacturers also use stealth methods to manipulate our love of fat, sugar, and salt. Maltodextrin, a nearly undetectable starch derivative, is used to thicken salad dressing or make beers taste richer, for example. This substance doesn't taste sweet to most people, but it has the same chemical structure, the same number of calories, and the same potential to make us overeat as sugar. This, Moss writes, makes it highly useful to food manufacturers. Now, processed foods send signals to the brain when they hit our tongue, and as they're digested, they also get into our bloodstream, just like drugs and alcohol. Glucose can start arriving in the blood within 10 minutes of eating something, which is as fast as snorted cocaine, Moss writes. Products that are highly refined will send our blood sugar soaring the fastest, and the faster it soars, the faster it hits the reward system in the brain. Furthermore, new research suggests that the faster a food hits our bloodstream and raises our blood sugar, the more our blood sugar crashes afterwards. That drop, Moss writes, prods the brain into making more dopamine that calls upon us to look for more food. The fact that processed foods are far easier and less expensive to score than cigarettes or drugs also makes us lust for them, even if the high is less intense. So they talk about this thing, and it's very interesting how they use food, and the food can actually, you know, be kind of destructive. So just be mindful of what you eat and what you put into your bodies, because it looks like it's another war and a money grab, but be careful because you don't want to be wilding around with high blood pressure and diabetes and all of the other things that come with it, the things that they hide behind you craving for sugar, cheese, fast foods, and other things like that. So, you know, and it's legal. So just be careful of that. All right? What'd you think about that, bro?
Hey, that was deep. I was checking that out, and I'm wondering what the heck. You know, we just eat way too many bad things and everything. I know I talked to my friend Kara Oker, and she's always talking about that because she's a nutrition expert and all of that. So I'm going to try to get her to come back and join us and everything. But I definitely think that it's way too much of that going on in the world, the bad eating and all of that. So we got to do better with our diet and everything that we've got going on. I agree with you that there's too much of the bad things that are out there, and we've got to do a much better job.
Mm-hmm. Yes, we do. Yes, we do. Hey, man, we got a guest that's standing by, and we'll bring him in and have a nice little conversation, so we'll find out who's at the door, and we'll go from there, all right?
It sounds like a plan.
Yeah, definitely. Thanks for calling Straight Talk with Dean and Mark. You are now on the line. Tell us who you are and where you're calling from. Caller, you are now on the line. All right, we'll come back to you.
We'll come back to them. We've got to find out where they are. Maybe you got to chit-chat with them and see what's going on in their world. I was expecting Miss Sandia Frontera to call. She's an empowerment trainer and an author and a divorce attorney. So I was expecting her to call in at some point. That might have been her on the other line. So we'll see if that was her or not. But I know that's one of the guests that I had called in and asked to call in today, but I'd asked some other folks to call as well. So, you know, I'm always trying to find us some great guests. So I'm not sure whether that was her or one of the other folks. You might have been hearing us banter back and forth and trying to figure out when do I get my part into the party. So we'll have to figure that out. I know that Dean is talking to them and is going to try to figure out what they've got going on in that regards. So I don't know if you want to try to chit-chat with them and see whether that's the person that I'm expecting or whether it's somebody else, and we want to play some music while we wait. But definitely there's a lot of things going on in the world, a lot of things that people are concerned about. You mentioned that stimulus, but you also mentioned the minimum wage. Actually, I had Bill Trezor on, I think it was yesterday, tell me that he expects that we will get that increase in minimum wage after a while.
It's necessary, man. You think, if you look, it's been 7.25 for almost 30 years, I think. That's a long time when you have prices like that. I went to get gas today, right? And so the other day when I passed the gas station, I looked at it, it was like $2.59. So I'm like, all right, I'm getting low, got to get some gas. I'm pulled up, I was like, yo, $2.89. I was like, here we go. We get ready to go over $3 before the summertime hits if it keeps going this way. But how does a person who, like I said, if they're making ends meet, if they have children, you know, do they have to work two or three jobs to get enough money to live comfortably? It doesn't make sense when we're able to help, you know, sending these little stimulus checks here and there. Yeah, that's a nice little piece of pocket change for some people. It's everything for other people. So why not raise the minimum wage? You know, you could argue on both sides of that. Some people will say, well, if you want a job that pays that much, you should get more education and all of this stuff. However, education is out, it's overpriced as well. So everywhere they turn, they hit a brick wall. What do you do when you keep hitting brick walls? If you turn to the right, you hit a brick wall. You turn to the right four times, you're encased in a small room. You have nowhere to go, you know, and so things remain the same. At what point do people say, you know what, you know, XYZ country, you know, we gave you $38 million last year and every year for the last 20 years. And so this year we're going to give you $2 million because the other 36 we need to use over here with our own people, you know. I just don't understand the concept of taking care of everyone else and not taking care of home. You know, I don't know.
No, I agree with you 100%. We got to take care of making sure that our folks are fed, and we still got folks that are homeless. We still got folks that are dealing with a number of other issues right here in the various parts. And it's not just the big cities. It's also some of our small towns that folks are facing these problems, including, like you mentioned earlier, the electric bill, the water bill, the telephone bill, a number of other bills as well. So, and that's just the basic core surface. And you know, we've been in the middle of this pandemic for over, I want to say, was it the first day back in March of last year? So I think we're almost getting to approach a year anniversary.
Oh, yeah. You talk about for the pandemic? About 15
right,
days.
Right, the pandemic.
About 15 days.
15 days.
Right. Yep, in about 15 days, it'll be a year, man. That went by quickly.
Yeah, it definitely went by real quickly and all of that. But, yeah, a lot of folks are very much concerned about that, trying to figure out what's going on in that regard and trying to figure out what's happening in their world and definitely trying to figure out a lot of things that are going on. What do you think about Mr. Garland? I know he ran into problems when he was trying to be a Supreme Court judge, but do you think that they're going to pass him, or do you think we're going to not have him pass at all and he's going to have to find somebody else?
It depends on who he's connected to. And, you know, they play that game also. It's one of those. Now, if he's done something that they can dig up and they can, like, body slam him with, he's done. And they won't put themselves out there for him because they have to watch their own backs and make sure that they look pristine when it's time to get some more support, if you will. But if it's something that can be doubted, downplayed, or dismissed, then he may have a chance. He may have a chance.
Yeah.
Like I said, Doug, it's going to be interesting.
Oh, it's going to be real interesting. I'm really curious to see how that plays out and what happens with that, because definitely it's going to be a concern to a number of folks. So it's going to be interesting to see whether he gets in. I think that might be one of the more troublesome ones. I think that the lady with interior should get in, and I'm pretty sure some of the other ones are still there. But I want to say that this might be in the latest of some of our appointments, because I know there have been other times we've had appointments and pretty much a whole staff ready by March or April. We're already on March 1st, and there's still a lot of the appointments that are still out there. So I'm wondering when President Biden is going to have a full cabinet.
He'll get it. It just may take a little longer because, you know, going to present some folks. They're going to get shot down. Going to present some more folks. They're going to get shot down. And then finally you present somebody and they'll say, you know what? All right. We'll take this one. Who do you have next? You know, so it's all a game. All of that stuff is a game. It's like the biggest soap opera in the United States. It's like,
so wait a minute,
you
mean to say that it's better than All My Children and Bold and the Beautiful?
It's a real life. I bet you if we went there, man, and just sat there and just watched, we'll probably see so much stuff, man, we could write 2 or 3 books on.
Oh, I'm sure. I am sure. There are probably people that have got those secret books, but, you know, there's also the danger of knowing too much of that knowledge, because some people might know that you know that knowledge, and they might find a way to take you out.
Yeah, maybe. You know, it'll be interesting to see if they, I don't know. I don't know.
I agree. It's going to be interesting to see how it all plays out and all of that, and whether they've got that kind of ability and what's going to happen in that regard. How is your basketball team doing these days? Because I know mine, I haven't even seen how the 76ers are doing under Doc Rivers. I know my Marquette team came down, actually upset the UNC team, and then turned around and got spanked by Connecticut. So, like I said, I think they came down on like a Tuesday or Wednesday, upset UNC. Nobody's expecting it because we had a losing record. And then they turned around and did what they were expected to do, which was get spanked by Connecticut.
Oh, see, I'm stuck, man. After the Super Bowl, I'm kind of done until August, man. I used to watch basketball, but it's been years since I've actually watched a basketball game. It's kind of like, all right, well, we'll get ready for football season, and we know that comes late August, early September. So, you know, hopefully the right moves will be made and we'll have a contender next year. We did okay this year. Could have done better, but what's done is done. So, you know,
right.
just waiting for – I'm waiting for football season to circle back around, man, because it's going to be, you know – I like football. So good games are good games, man. I just root for, you know, my team, and then we go from there, you know?
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. You got to root for your team, and then y'all go from there and see how the team goes and all of that. So we got to play those teams one at a time and all of that. But, you know, they're also saying that this basketball and COVID may have an interesting allyship. Because I was reading an article over the weekend where they said that the NIT actually may have the strongest lineup of all, because there are possibilities that some of the blue blood clubs like Duke and UNC and Kentucky might actually wind up playing in the NIT.
Wow.
So that, yeah, I've already talked about that. So that'll be interesting. We got Blue Bloods playing in the NIT and then like some mid-majors playing in the NCAA. But I think that'll upset a lot of people's brackets and they'll be trying to figure out what's going on in that regard and everything. I know we were talking about the vaccines and I talked to my Aunt Julie. She's definitely got hers along with her husband, my Uncle Randy. But have all the family members that you have that are able to get the vaccine, have they got the vaccine or do you have some other family members that are still out there waiting to get it? And what's your thoughts on that? Because I know there's new vaccines that are coming out and definitely there are vaccines out there. But I just wondered if your elderly family members have gotten theirs. Because I was talking to my Aunt Julie and she said that I think last week they went and got theirs and they may even be on the booster shot already.
I would have to check because there's only two remaining elders in my, you know, direct family, three. My father, his sister, and then my uncle on my mother's brother-in-law. So everyone else has passed on way before this pandemic, but now I have to check to find out if they have already, you know, taken a shot or whatnot. Right now, it's three different shots out there, man. Take one of them. That's how I feel, you know. A lot of people will say, well, I'm anti-vaccine or I'm not anti-vaccine. I just don't trust the shot, but you trust the iPhone. When the new model comes out in April and then a newer model comes out by November and you don't question technology then, you know, you don't question technology when your car, you could trade it in for a newer model with all these different upgrades. So in the age of technology, why would you not think, you know, it doesn't take 9 months to a year, 2-3 years to come up with a vaccine or, you know, something that will help the people. And now the new conspiracy is the different strands. There's different strands of the flu every year. But I still go get that flu shot, you know, because at this point, when you... It started out, it sounded like a hoax to everybody because the person in charge called it the China virus. And we were like, that sounds real dumb. The China virus. Yeah, I ain't going to worry too much about that. But then people started to get sick. And more people got sick. And it seemed like every day, every time you turn on the television, the news had 3,000, 5,000, 10,000 new cases. And I'm like, damn. This is spreading like wildfire. We need to start paying attention. And then one of my friends ended up succumbing to the virus. You know, rest in peace to Dr. Gerald Glisson, who's my fraternal brother. And then it really became real because it's somebody you know. It wasn't somebody you heard of. It's somebody you actually know. Now the game is totally different. And then when you look now, 500,000 people have passed away from this virus. It has no respect. It doesn't care how old you are. Doesn't care what race you are, your economic status. It's taking people out, man. And 500,000 people in the United States, I'm not even talking about in the world, 500,000 people in this country. So, when you look at those numbers, it's like, you know what? Yeah, let me go ahead and get this shot. I had my second shot this past Friday, man. And I was like, it's done. You know, for me, somebody said, well, you can still get sick. Yeah, you can still get sick from anything. You could pass away in the next 5 minutes. But it wasn't because of the shot you took. It was just time. And the Most High decided it was your time. You know, so sometimes we got to get out of our own way. You know, people are dying from this and you still have people out there with these weird conspiracies. They can't support it with any kind of evidence other than going back into the past, you know, to hear someone say, oh, well, it's another Tuskegee experiment. What year were you born? And you're born right at the end of that experiment or way after. Well, you weren't even alive when this took place. What the fuck are you talking about? Like, sometimes you just need to sit down and you know, use your brain like you don't even know what was happening because you weren't even on this earth. Your parents didn't even think about creating you yet. But you're talking about something that you had to Google. Oh, okay. Yeah, I'm not listening to you anymore. Because your conversation is trash now. You know, it's like me trying to tell somebody about the civil rights movement, and I was born in the early 70s. You know, so I wasn't around during that time. For those who lived it, yeah, you can tell me about it because you lived it. You were there. I wasn't there. You know, so how can I say, well, during the civil rights movement, unless I'm quoting someone else's words, I witnessed nothing firsthand. So, you know, sometimes I look at some stuff, man, and I'm like, y'all gotta be kidding me. But if you want to go ahead and suffer, then that's on you. You know, if you want to do it, you want a chance death? Go ahead. That's on you.
Yeah, too many people want to try to make those unnecessary suffering moves and all of that. I don't know why they want to do that. They just got that suffering mentality. So sometimes folks just want to suffer way too much, and they just need to stop the madness. There's no doubt about that. They need to stop the madness and let folks just have peace of mind, because we've even talked that about on a number of shows. One of the things that I know that Zach was talking about on his show, and I'd love to hear your thoughts about it, because I've been talking to a number of folks about this whole concept of cancel culture, where people are going out there and dissing people because they don't have the same beliefs as they do, whether it's on Facebook or social media. And then I've also come up with a new term. I call it self-canceling culture, where people are even canceling their own cultures because they don't understand the greatness that they have. So, and then they want to get caught up in the cancel culture societies. So, what are your thoughts about those that want to cancel folks because of their race, religion, or the way they are?
You know what? If they're not your friends, you know what? Hey, man, they don't even matter. You know, a lot of times people will want to cancel you because you hold the unpopular opinion. And for someone like me, that's fine because I stand firm in my beliefs and, you know, you don't have to like what I say. I didn't say it for you, for your approval. You know, I didn't give you a permission slip and say, hey, look, is it all right if I say this? Nah, I'm saying how I feel because it comes from my heart. People have to respect the differences in each other and also respect the fact that everything is not going to be readily accepted. For those of us who are older, we understand this concept. For those who are younger, it's like, oh, well, you know, you're toxic, you're this, you're that. Any name that they can give you to make themselves feel better without realizing that during the time I grew up, man, there's certain things that just didn't happen. And, you know, I stand firm in that. I don't necessarily care for it. If that's you, be you. But as long as you're a decent person to me, that's what matters. The second you cross that line is the second you get caught out there or you get checked. If you will, you know what I mean? So everybody doesn't have to accept it, but it's almost like you're being force fed certain things. Turn on the TV, you'll see exactly what I'm talking about. And it's the same thing. And then it's like, well, for years people have seen this, so now you're seeing this. All right, well, I'm changing the channel because I really don't, that's not my thing, you know? And then it's like, oh, well, you don't like that? Well, don't put words in my mouth, because I will articulate it to a point where it'll make you hate me. And I'll do it just because. Uh-huh. You know what I'm saying? It's not saying that I actually feel that way, but you know what? I just might make it that way so that you never speak to me again. Because what I don't want to do is to get into a debate about how I feel, what my core beliefs are. I'm not going to argue about my core beliefs because they're mine. You know, I don't owe you to explain myself to you or to anybody. And I think that's a big thing. You know, everybody wants to be loved and everybody wants to be readily accepted. But then they go along with everything just to get along. I missed that bus a long time ago. And I never looked for it to come back around. You know what I mean? So when they talk about cancel culture, it's a group of folks trying to make themselves feel better because there's something missing in them and an inadequacy which they're trying to project onto somebody else, and they do it that way because it's a group of those that feel bad trying to make themselves feel better. So, oh, we're going to cancel this person. We don't like what they said about you know, the LGBTQ community. We don't like what they said about black folks. We don't like what they said about the Asian community, the Latino community. You know what, man? It's too much work. If you got all that time to be sitting there crying and whining about it, it's some shit you could have been doing to better your community, your situation, or whatever. Because nobody's situation is perfect. But at the same time, some things folks like, some things folks don't like. You deal with the people that like the things that you like. And then the world will be a better place. Don't worry about those people, you know, like all of those people that are out there still racist, as proven by the last president. I'm not going out there looking for them. They don't matter to me. You know what I mean? They don't matter to me. So I'm not going to look for them and say, oh, you're wrong because the Civil Rights Act was passed. Man, I don't give a damn what you do as long as you stay on that side of the street. Now, if you come over to this side of the street, we're going to have an issue. And I'm going to let you know we got an issue. And I got a plan of action, that plan to take if you come across the street. But as long as you stay over there, you can say whatever you want to about me because everything you say is wrong because you don't know who I am. You don't know what I bring to the table. In fact, we're not even sitting at the same table because that's by choice. Not because you kept it from me. It's because I choose not to associate with you. So, you know... It's a thing, like I said, it's a feel good action, but at the end of the day, what does it actually do? You know, what does it actually do? People say boycott this, hit them in the pocket. Well, for every 10 people that's boycotting, there's 100 people support them. So tell me where it really breaks down. You know, this guy, what the guy from Bed Bath and Beyond, they were like, yo, cancel him. Yeah, but he got hurt in the pockets because it seemed like everybody canceled him. Even the people that was once with him was like, nah, we ain't messing with you no more. So in that case, yeah, it did get him. But in the majority of cases, when folks were talking about boycotting the NFL, I was like, the average NFL patron is a 35-year-old white guy with access to money over $150,000 a year. Average. Who's you're watching the game on TV? He's going to the game, buying 6 or 7 beers while he's there. The beer's like $25-$30 a beer, and then he's gonna get something to eat. He spent about $400 after he paid for the ticket. You know what I mean? You go to the game for him, it's a $1,500 night. For us, it's a $60-$70 ticket in the nosebleed seats. Where you know, sometimes we got to be a little bit more cognizant of what, you know, you just can't boycott everything because everybody ain't going to ride with you. 80% of the people, they said, during the Civil Rights Movement, did absolutely nothing. Absolutely nothing. But everybody has a story about what took place during that time, because the greatest story ever told is one where, if I tell a group of young folks what took place in the early 90s and I make myself a superstar in the process, when I walk away, they're going to say, yo, that's a bad man right there.
That was that superstar from the 90s.
Yeah, like, he was that guy. But then when you, for those who, like, man, he's just a regular dude. This motherfucker had, like, 3 part-time jobs and went to college. They'd be like, what? Oh, he ain't do shit. But while there's nobody there to refute my story, I can embellish and say what I want, you know, and I think that's what's happening too.
Yeah, you can make that story any story you want to make it. There's no doubt about that. You can just say anything that you feel like and all of that. I don't know what happened to her. I guess it was going to call in. They appeared to have disappeared on us, but definitely I was hoping they were going to pop in. Maybe they're still listening and maybe they'll join us. I did send an email to them and everything. One thing that I was going to say is that this is Women's History Month, so definitely I know I've got some very important women in my life. Of course, my mom, Valeria Lee, and of course, my aunt that is still living and all that, as well as several lady cousins. But I want to give a shout out to Mom and definitely her two living sisters, Yvonne Hedgepeth and Julie Walker. I actually talked to Aunt Julie yesterday, so I know a number of folks have been thinking that this is the month of women's history, and they want to give shout outs to the important women in their lives. I can also think about the ancestral women, like my grandmother Molly, who set up the Richard B. Harrison Library over there in Raleigh. So Molly set it up in Raleigh. So definitely glad to have her memories and everything. And my grandma Mary, who was there in Holliston, involved with her church. And then, of course, a whole host of women that are important friends and all of that. So definitely just remember that this is Women's History, Women's History Month. And just like we did with Black History Month, there have been a number of great accomplishments by many of our women leaders. So think about the women in your life. But I know Dean is married, so he'll be thinking, of course, during this month about his wife, but he thinks about her all the time because they're like a superstar tandem and all of that. So I know that they are always thinking about each other in that regard. And of course, he'll be thinking about other lady family members in his life, as well as just as well as some of the great ones like Rosa Parks and a number of other ones, and Susan B. Anthony. So definitely some great women that have come out here and made some great contributions to society. So historically speaking, who are some of your favorite women? I know I was a big fan of Madame Curry and a number of others, but who are some of your favorite women leaders or just women in general?
I would say all of the women that I guess molded me into who I am. My you know, that they're mostly, in fact, they're all in heaven now. My mother, Claudette Johnson Piercy, my godmother, Hazel Stone Rainey, you know, they were both English teachers. So I learned the King's English the hard way, but you know, my aunts, Mildred Johnson G, Sandra Johnson Mickens, Cassie Plummer Johnson, Irene Winston, Lillian Pigram, Sylvia Brown. I'm trying to think. This is like all of those. That was my village, you know. And then when you look outside, I don't know. I mean, I would say this. Every female that I went to school with at the Virginia State University, the land of Troy, that is out here now, raising families, taking care of the kids, and also doing big things, I salute them too, because, you know, like, we grew up together. And that includes those who graduated with me from high school, and there were maybe a few years before, a few years after me, Petersburg High School, Petersburg, Virginia. I've had a chance to meet a whole lot of amazing women in this thing we call life. And were they famous? Yeah, famous to their families, you know, and to those who know them and love them. Not famous as like big glitz and glamour, starlights and all of that stuff, but they still superstars nonetheless. So Danger Geronimo salutes all of you for, you know, for being you. And for making history every day, because some people figure it's only the big events that make history, but you know, you end up making history every single day, especially when, you know, your interactions with people and how you portray yourself to the world, you know. Salute to all of them, man.
Oh yeah, gotta give a big salute out to those amazing women. And they've done some amazing things in the society. And I was just actually, as you were saying, all of those women in your life, I was thinking about the great women entrepreneurs. I know that there have been some amazing ones that I've had conversations with, like Maxine Phelps McCoy, and definitely a number of other great women entrepreneurs out there that are doing some amazing things as well. And of all different age ranges, like I said, some of these women entrepreneurs, in fact, I met one yesterday, I want to say is in college right now, so she's probably in her late teens and all of that. And of course, there are even some young women and men entrepreneurs that are in the kid range. So definitely don't think that the entrepreneurs and these great women are only in the one circle or another. They come from all aspects of our society. So definitely glad to have met some new women entrepreneurs as well this week and last week. So hoping that some of them will be calling out and reaching to us in the very near future. Definitely, there's some amazing women entrepreneurs and all of that. So I know a lot of folks are definitely paying attention to a number of things going on in the world. So I'm going to see what I can find out happening in the news and everything. Because I saw that you had checked out some news articles earlier, and I did see some things that had surprised me, and I'm sure they probably surprised you as well. Because one thing, believe it or not, Zoom is still in the news. Because I saw Zoom was in the news, and I'm like, wait a minute, why is Zoom in the news? Because people are thinking about how they're Zoomed out and all of that. I think that was the kind of course of the Zoom thing. And I know here in North Carolina, we were doing the testing has been impacted. Zoom has impacted it. And I think the majority of our students actually did not pass standardized testing this year, according to an article that I read earlier today, because they're not really feeling this whole hybrid computer version of learning. They'd rather be in there with their teachers and all of that. But yeah, there was an article on LinkedIn that says, we're learning more about why Zoom meetings and video conferences on similar platforms can leave us drained. Stanford University published the first peer-reviewed study of the pandemic-era phenomenon and found that people are constantly looking at each other directly and up close, which is behavior ordinarily reserved for close relationships. Also, nonverbal cues are harder to send and receive through video chats, and seeing yourself for extended periods of time and having limited mobility can become sources of stress. Researchers say their aim is to isolate research areas for social scientists and to suggest design improvements for technologists. So they're going to try to make us have some better chairs and everything, so we're going to sit in front of the computer. At least we can be more comfortable while we're being tortured and all of that. So definitely that's one of the things that's going on. So they're going to try to find a way to make us more comfortable and all of that.
You know what? I guess you got to learn how to go ahead and switch that, put your profile picture up, and just keep it moving. Now, some organizations do have these rules that say, you have to keep your camera on at all times, and I feel bad for them, man, because I don't mean no harm. That might be your rule, but I'm not good at following that one, because I will throw my profile picture up real quick, lean back and just listen, take notes on what I feel is, important, and then we rock from there, because you're not going to make me just sit there staring at people for a whole hour or 2 hours or whatever. I can't do it. I'll get up and just leave it where it is, and I'll come back to it. You tell me what happened when I get back.
Come back and be like, is that what happened?
Yeah, man.
You would handle it?
They'd be like, we were calling you. Oh, yeah, I had to take a step away for a second. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know. It's just when you sit there and you're on the and you're staring at each other and staring at each other and staring at each other, it's kind of like, and then you got the, folks that come on late and they come in and they want to say, good evening, like, shut up. Somebody else is already talking, and you're late, so please shut up.
You're late.
Or they say, can you hear me? Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Yes, man, we can hear you. Get to saying what you wanted to say.
That's right. Get to your report, see what you got to say, and all of that. Well, they are saying that even the employers are mapping out their work from home and work and everything, because one of the articles I'm reading, it says that major tech employers are reviving their discussions on work from home perks and pay now that companies worldwide are entering their second year of going remote. The Wall Street Journal reports issues such as tax burdens and parental support are being weighed across industries, with Facebook requiring employees to update their location for tax purposes. So they want to know exactly where you are while you're filing your taxes, even though you're not in Facebook's physical office. So you might work for Facebook, which I know is a West Coast based company, and living in New Hampshire. So they want to know what you've got going on in to report your exact state and exactly where you are and all of that.
No.
No.
You know what? And the crazy thing about that is you can go on Facebook, I could go on Facebook right now and I could put I'm down there where you are in North Carolina, right? And it'll pop up and say that, I'm with you in North Carolina right now. So if somebody doesn't know, they'd be like, man, you travel down there, you know, what's going on down there or whatever. And then you're like, yeah, I'm down here in North Carolina right now. When actually I'm in New Jersey in my house.
Right. So in your house.
If I can put wherever I want to be in this world as a post for my current location, why you want to know where I am while I'm filing my taxes? Like, the government's going to find that out once the paperwork is transmitted. They're going to know exactly where I was. Facebook, why you need to know this? You're going to give me some money? Tell me something.
Yeah, tell me you're going to give me some money. We need the money. But, you know, apparently Spotify is having a work from anywhere plan where they're saying that they are going to pay higher tier New York and San Francisco salaries. So even though they're saying that you can work from anywhere, they're paying higher tier salaries, it looks like, for New York and San Francisco people. So I'm a little bit confused there. Maybe they're paying you those higher tier salaries depending on where you're at. So even if you are working from Kansas, you can still get those high end salaries. Okay, that I'll buy.
It says
the employers are trying to keep workers engaged and happy without getting into any regulatory issues. So they're concerned about their regulatory issues. You know, big time got to worry about Big Brother watching even corporate America and all of that. So they're worried about what's going to go on in that regard. So that's what they're concerned about and all of that. And apparently, they did axe the wage boost from the stimulus. So you were right about that. So they did axe the wage boost from the stimulus. So it says Senate Democrats jettisoned a plan to tax companies unless they raise the minimum wage to $15. Meaning the chamber, which they did, voted on the $1.9 trillion stimulus. But they got rid of that mandatory thing of the $15 minimum wage. I'm with you, what you said earlier. We should have had that minimum wage a long time ago. I don't know how anybody... I'm thinking most people need at a minimum $20, $20-$25 an hour, and definitely nothing less than that. I don't know how people are getting by on a lot of these crazy salaries that are out there that people are collecting, particularly anything around $10 or along those lines. So we've got to find a way to get some better salaries out there for all of our people, not just the fast food workers, but everybody, because there are a number of folks that are working these crazy jobs and not getting paid what they are worth. So we've got to do much better in terms of making sure people are getting their worth and all of that. Do y'all folks in corrections feel y'all are getting paid what y'all should be getting in terms of your pay and what the kind of work you do? Or do you think that that's something else that needs improvement? Do we need better pay in corrections?
In certain states, I would say yes. Here in New Jersey, it's a little different. For an entry-level position in the Department of Corrections, they start out like at $40,000, right? But on a scale, let's fast forward 10 years, they're making almost double, and with the overtime, they may go into six figures. For those who are civilian, which I am now, I came out of uniform, but for what I do, I get paid all right. I ain't going to complain about my salary. You know what I mean? Now, in other states, it is totally different. You know, I'll use Virginia as an example. Coming into corrections in Virginia, your starting pay is going to be about $27,000, $28,000 a year. And then, you know, you get to make more money by working overtime, of course. But look at just that difference in entry-level salary. In Virginia, it's $27,000, $28,000. In New Jersey, it's almost $45,000 now. And that's two people, the same age, no experience, starting at the same time. Different states, different pay. You know what I mean?
Wow.
So it's not standard across the board now, unless you go into the federal system where, you know, that GS-5 is, that's how much you're getting paid until, you know, you get promoted or you get that annual step increase or what have you. But on the state system and in the local jails and lockups and stuff like that, it varies depending on what state you live in. And that was one of the reasons why I came from Virginia to New Jersey, because you make more money. You know, like, it's just the bottom line. It wasn't like, oh, I had to be in New Jersey. But when you look at how much the pay is, and then you look at the other area and you say, you know what, it may make a little more sense to try to get into the department up here, because over time you end up making more money, you know. Do you work for it? Yeah, you do work for it, but at the same time, it's different. It's even like that in retail. Before I started in corrections, when I was up here before I moved back to Virginia, you know, I was an assistant manager in a retail store, and I was making like $40,000 then, and that was the mid to late 90s, and I was like, all right, for the time, I'm doing pretty good. You know, I'm young. I'm still in my 20s. I'm making like 40 grand. You know, back then, money was a little different then. You know?
Yeah.
So then ended up moving to Virginia with the company. They allowed me to transfer. And then one day, the regional manager came in. She's sitting in the back. And she was kind of like, how much money do you make? And I was like, well, that's a dumb question, because you had to sign off on my paperwork for the transfer to go through, because you had to sign me to a store. She was like, right. Yeah, I know that, but how much money do you make? And I was like, man, I'm not answering a question you already have the answer to. She was like, well, I'm asking this question because when we reviewed your paperwork, you make more than the store manager. And I was like, okay, but does the store manager have the credentials that I have? I've already had 6 years in retail, 5-6 years as a retail manager. I have a college degree, you know, so I can kind of justify why I'm being paid what I'm being paid. She said, well, in this area, no. You know, the highest an assistant store manager can make in this area is $30,000. And I was like, ooh. So am I being promoted? You know, that's my first thought. And then she was like, nah, we got a store manager. We got a store manager. He's not leaving, and you're going to have to sign this paper. So when I look at the paper, it shows the $45,000 I was getting paid. And then the next column said new salary, and it said $30,000. And I looked at that thing real hard, man, and I was like, all right, you know what? I signed it. So I left out of there. I was like, yo, great, go home, change my clothes, I'll be back. Y'all never went back. I got in the car, so picked off, man. I drove 2 hours, almost 3 hours north to Northern Virginia, where I used to live. I kind of hung out there for a little bit, drove back home. When I got home, my dad was there, and he was like, man, they've been looking for you all day. Where have you been? And I told him what happened. He's like, so what you gonna do? I was like, man, listen, I ain't gonna be unemployed for long, but I can't. The stroke of a pen took $15,000 away from me. And it, like I said, money was different. $45,000 was a whole lot, as opposed to now you put me at 30. Like, nah, that's all right. And then some people will say, well, what sense did that make when you ended up getting a job in corrections at $26,000? You shorted yourself some more. I said, well, no, not really, because after I finished that probationary period, we were working overtime hand over fist. So now I'm making 60, 70, you know, I'm working a lot, but at the same time, I'm able to bring that money in now by working overtime, the post that they needed assistance with and things like that. So you do have the ability to work overtime and make more money, but when you just look at the base salary and corrections, you know, it's, some people would say they need more, some people would say they need less, but right now, here where I am now, I believe it's a fair number.
Fair numbers are good to have and everything. I was just, this other interesting article as well. I think it was the last week or the week before we were talking about Bitcoins. Well, there's a new Bitcoin player, believe it or not. Looks like Walmart is trying to get into the fintech industry as well. So it says that Walmart has poached two senior bankers from Goldman Sachs to help run its new fintech startup, is what Bloomberg reports, citing anonymous sources. A move that has struck fear on Wall Street as the world's largest retailer muscles its way into financial services. So Goldman's consumer banking chief Omar Ismail and one of his top deputies, David Stark, have signed on to Walmart's fintech venture, which vows to develop affordable financial products for employees and customers. It's a heavy blow to the most gilded name on Wall Street, with banks raising concern over Walmart's foray into finance. So what do you think about the fact that you might get some Bitcoin at your local Walmart or whatever new form of money they decide to come up with, the Walmart coin?
I don't know about that, man. I mean, some people say they got in when it first started out and they have a whole lot of money now, but for some reason, man, I don't see that like going too well for too much. Like, it's a fad. You know how those fads come in and everybody's on it and then everybody's off of it and it tanks. So I'm wondering, is it going to be that way or is it going to be something that's going to be like self-sustaining that will be around for quite a while?
Yeah, I'm wondering that same thing. I've heard people even speculating that it could be the new form of cash and all of that, but I have my doubts as well because it just seems a little bit too suspicious, I guess is the best word I could use, because I'm thinking there's got to be some catches and all of that, but I'm not ready to jump on the fintech or the Bitcoin bandwagon as of yet. I definitely need to learn more about what's happening and how it's happening, because I'm not convinced. I don't know if you are, but I need more convincing.
I just need to, if you let me put $50 in it, and let's see what happens to the $50. And if it grows, then you made me a believer. If it fails, then that's what I thought. You know what I mean? But I don't want to, I'm not into taking those risks, man. In fact, could be to my detriment, because years ago when a little thing called Google first came out and they had shares like $20 a share, I mean, they were brand new and it seemed like the stock was dirt cheap, right? And I was like, man, Google? The fuck is that? We got AOL, we got Hotmail. I couldn't see it, man. Like, I'm sitting there like, Google? Nobody's going to use that. Like, nah. I'll pass. You know what I'm saying? And I look now, and you fast forward, and one share of Google stock is worth $2,069.66. Oh, my God.
If only you had known.
One $20. Just think, man.
One share.
Look at that. Like, I need to punch myself in the face for that one. Because when you think of it, I could have gotten like, let's say, 50 shares, right?
Yep. Uh-huh.
So if I got 50 shares, I'm just trying to do some math over here. 50 shares at $20, spent $1,000 on Google stock, right? So 50 shares.
Right.
So,
yep.
To take that 2,069, right?
Uh-huh.
So 2,069 times 50, man, that $1,000 investment would be worth
$103,450. Yep.
Damn. Damn it, man. You know, like, for $2,000, I have $250,000. But I couldn't.
You didn't see the big picture.
Nah, I didn't see that at all. Did not see that at all. And I guess if you split it, I could have gotten half a million out of it. I don't know.
Yep. But you just mentioned a service that I don't even know if people use anymore. I know people still use AOL to some degree, but you just said Hotmail, and I don't even know the last time I saw a Hotmail account on one of the emails from a friend to me and everything. Because, like I said, everybody's on Gmail, which is the Google Mail, and they still use Yahoo and a number of other ones. But I'm even trying to think the last time that I got a email from Hotmail, and it's probably been a while because I sure can't think of it.
I know somebody who still has a Hotmail account, man. And for me, you know, they're like, yo, send me an email. I was like, all right, what's your email address? And when they said what it was at hotmail.com, I was like, Hotmail? Like, you still got that shit? It still works?
Yeah.
It was just crazy, man, because it was like, well, it's like, if it ain't broke, don't fix it.
Yeah, that's the way some people feel about their accounts and everything. You know, I know the folks who still got their Black Planet accounts and their MySpace accounts. I think MySpace is still out there, but that's another one that has disappeared in terms of its practicality and its usability, because I don't know many people that still go on there on a regular basis. I think Black Planet is probably still used fairly actively, but who was the last time you knew somebody that wasn't a teenager that was on MySpace?
MySpace? Is that,
and I'm not
still
even sure they're on that.
Can
is it still around? That's a good question.
Like, you know what? I'm going to see if it works. I'm going to go on Chrome on my phone and put in www.myspace.com. I know for a while when everybody left it and went to Facebook, a lot of artists were using it to post stuff on their pages and whatnot. But
yeah,
when you click on myspace.com, it's like all this news and stuff is up there. It's local news. So I guess, you know, you still can use it.
I guess so. But like I said, I don't know the last time I even went to a MySpace account or anything of that nature. But I guess you can still use it. But who's using it and why they're using it is beyond me.
Hey, like I said, some people, it still works. So
as long as it works, that's what counts and everything. Speaking of things that are working, I know that one of the things that we've got going on this week, and I hope folks will check it out, but both the Carolina Theater and the HI Heritage Center, two places that I have very dear to my heart, the Carolina Theater because it's a place that I serve on their board, and the HI Heritage Center because of long-time employment there and everything, but they are both doing their film festivals, and of course they are virtual film festivals. I think they're using a platform called Eventif, but definitely you can go there or to either the Carolina Theater or to HI, and you can catch some amazing films. The HI one started today on March 1st, and I think runs to the 6th. And the Nevermore Film Festival, which is the one that the Carolina Theater is doing, which deals with drama and definitely deals with horror and fantasy and all of that, they are going on. They actually open on Friday, and I think they run to the 4th, which will be on Thursday or something like that. So definitely some great films. I've actually watched some of them. Had some of the filmmakers on some of our other streaming podcasts, broadcasts and everything. So definitely keep that in mind. Go out and check both of those venues. And I think you'll see some movies that are worth checking out. And they're definitely worth looking at. So definitely folks that are listening and are able to go into that part and support these great organizations, I hope that that's what you'll do, is go over there and support both the Carolina Theater and the HI Heritage Center as they are having both respectively their film festivals, or actually Carolina Theater does multiple film festivals, whereas HI just does one, but they do have one of their film festivals at the Carolina Theater, and the HI has its main one, so definitely, and its only one. So if you get a chance, go and check out these amazing works of filmmaking going on right here. I know my friend Kimberly Browning is going to be showing her film in the very near future, so look forward to having her come and share her film and all of that. So I'm looking forward to that in the very near future.
Nice. Definitely some big things always coming out of North Carolina, man.
And yeah, we try to keep things moving. And I know you're involved with Rhapsody and that whole thing that Nice has got going on, because he's always some amazing music going on and all of that. So as we get ready to, we'll probably come back and do some conversation a little bit more. I might try to reach out to some folks, but I need to also put a little bit of water in my throat. So I think Dean should play some of their music, and then we'll come back maybe at about the 8:25 mark, and by then I might have called the folks. And if not, we'll just wrap everything up with our conversation. But I think that our listeners deserve to hear some great music. Do you mind giving us some great music from the Nice Wonder Camp and Rhapsody and all those other amazing folks?
Well, you know what? I got all these instrumentals here, man. So what I'm going to do is just go down the list of the Ninth Wonder joints that I got. You know, I got a couple of them. So we'll just put some music on and we'll be back, man.
Sounds good.
All right.
Every day, I wake up at 5 a.m. to give Dad his medicine. Every day, I wake up at 5 a.m. to give Dad his medicine. At 6 a.m., I make his breakfast. Every day, I wake up at 5 a.m. to give Dad his medicine. At 6 a.m., I make his breakfast. At 7 a.m., I shower. Every day, I wake up at 5 a.m. to give Dad his medicine. At 6 a.m., I make his breakfast. At 7 a.m., I shower. I start laundry at 8. At 10, we go for a walk. Every day, I wake up at 5 a.m.
For those dealing with the daily struggles of caring for a loved one, we hear you. That's why AARP created a community with experts and other caregivers for advice, tips, and support. Together, let's help each other better care for ourselves and the ones we love. Visit aarp.org/caregiving. A public service announcement brought to you by AARP and the Ad Council.
Thank you.
Yep, we're back after hearing some great music and everything else. So definitely some great conversation, some great music, and Dean was over there just rocking. He was having his DJ set. We love what Dean has his DJ set. So definitely he was doing a good job and having some great music coming our way, and I know I do that DJ thing as well. Mine is usually blues or some Southern soul, but you were rocking that sounds, and I was sitting there going like, Dad, I need to have a club open right now so I can see getting my groove on, getting my dances on, and all of that. So, great set. Appreciate it. Great music coming our way. So that was definitely some fun music and a fun musical break. I know yesterday Zach was really pleased because he went and hung out with his daughter. They went and did some golfing and some throwing of the softball and everything along that line, because we had some temperatures around the 70s, and I think it might even be around the 50s and 60s now. But are you convinced that winter is done, or do you think we're going to get some more winter? It is March 1st, and winter is supposed to be in 2 or 3 weeks, about the same time that the pandemic started. So what is your thoughts? Are we going to have some winter, or is winter done, and we're going to get this early spring? Dean's gut feeling?
My gut and my bones say right now it's 46 degrees outside in New Jersey. Tomorrow it's going to be 36. Then like Wednesday, I'm reading this whole thing. Wednesday is like 52. Thursday is like 46. So that's as much as I can see right now. And then Friday, 38. Saturday, 40. Sunday, 40. Right now, up here, winter is still here, man. It's like I'm not going anywhere and you can't make me. So for us, you know, like down there where you are, it may start getting a little warmer. You said it was in the 70s yesterday. It was in the 50s up here. So
yeah, I think it was like, Zach told me it was like high 60s or low 70s, something like that. I'm actually going to pull up our Durham weather and see what it was earlier. I know when I stepped out earlier, we did have some rain earlier today, because, you know, that's the great thing about North Carolina weather. It can be lovely one day, and then you got rain the next day. So I'm sure the temperature dropped after that rain. But, you know, that's also good cold-catching weather as well. So, which in the middle of a pandemic is not a good thing if you're trying to catch a cold, because then folks wonder if it's cold or if it's the other thing. So, as and you were right. Like, right now, we were probably in the 50s or 60s. But tonight, it's supposed to get down to 34 degrees. Tomorrow, I guess winter is over for me, because tomorrow is supposed to be mostly cloudy, 52 degrees and 32. Wednesday is supposed to be 59, mostly sunny, and 39. And on the 4th, it's supposed to be 63 degrees. So that's probably more along the lines of what he was talking about, but it's supposed to be 63. But see, this is where that weather gets confusing in North Carolina, because it's supposed to be 63 at some point during the, you know, the midday, like when the sun is at its peak and all of that. But on that same day, at some point during the day, it's supposed to be 32. Go for it.
Yeah, see, that's not cool. Wow, man.
But I am looking at it. They're saying that on the 9th right now, which is next Tuesday, and I did come in Tuesday, but then we come tomorrow, it's going to be 65 and 42, and then on the 10th, it's going to be 68 and 50. So they are calling for some 60 degrees, but they're also saying that on the 7th, which is next, this coming Sunday, we're going to have a low of 27. So, like I said, this is that confusing weather where, you know, it's 1 minute it's nice and warm and you think that it's going to be spring and summer-like, and then you roll back outside and it's downright cold. So, like I said, this is that confusing, typical February and March weather that just loves to totally confuse us and also give us the sniffles and the colds and whatever else it feels like giving us.
Wow. That's crazy.
Yeah, that's just some crazy temperatures. As I'm sitting here looking at these temperatures, I'm going like, wait a minute. So you're telling me that it's supposed to be 34 later on tonight, 52 tomorrow, and then 32 that night, I'm guessing that night. And then on Wednesday, it's supposed to get up to 59 and the low 39. And then on Thursday, it's supposed to get all the way up to 63 again, a nice little temperature. But the low that night is supposed to be a lovely 32 degrees. But you know, there's some people out there in the world that don't think that climate change is real.
just like they don't believe that the coronavirus is not real. They'll soon find out. You know what I mean? They will soon
I'm wondering if these are the same people that back in the day, you know, like they're, if you believe in reincarnations or ancestors, I wonder if these are the same folks that back in the day in their reincarnated spirit believed that the earth was flat.
They probably did, man. They probably did. Yeah. And you know, they figure if you walk too far, you're going to fall straight off the, you know, nah, man, that's not going to happen. You'll be walking forever, and you'll never get to the end.
Walking forever. Right.
What are you,
but
what
these
are you
same folks, these same folks are some of those same folks that back, you know, centuries and decades ago may have believed that they were going to fall off the earth. And they might have also believed that the moon was made of cheese, because I remember that was another famous mythology and everything. So I think that these are some of the same folks that believe that, and probably also the same ones that cried rooster and all of that. So I think that these are some of these same people.
Yeah, it could be.
Could be very much well be going on. What's happening in the world of the news up there in New York? I know y'all have always got exciting things going on. Cuomo or somebody is always doing something fascinating. So
yeah,
what's happening in the world of New York and New Jersey politics?
You know what? I'll have to look that up, bro, because I don't, unless it directly affects me, I ain't trying to follow it too much. You'll go nuts. You know what I mean? Trying to follow all of this stuff that goes, damn, I just saw this article. It has nothing to do with what you just asked, but Don Robinson of En Vogue and the group Lucy Pearl.
I remember the group En Vogue.
And you remember she was a part of Lucy Pearl with Raphael Sadiq and Ali Shaheed Muhammad from A Tribe Called Quest.
Right.
And she blames Raphael Sadiq for the loss of her home. So it says, as a founding member of the R&B group, I don't know. I'm about to read it. I'm going to read it right here. As a founding member of the R&B group En Vogue, Dawn Robinson helped the ensemble become one of the world's best-selling female groups ever. The group reached top 10 status on Billboard with such songs as Hold On, My Lovin', You're Never Gonna Get It, Give Him Something He Can Feel, Free Your Mind, and Don't Let Go, Love. Robinson ultimately left the group in pursuit of a solo career, but decided to forego it in 1999 for a while to join the group Lucy Pearl. It's an R&B group which included singers Raphael Sadiq and A Tribe Called Quest's Ali Shaheed Muhammad. The group's self-titled 2000 album produced two singles, Don't Mess With My Man and Dance Tonight. Despite the album's success, Robinson left the group, in part because of various challenges and difficulties she was having with Sadiq, even though the two had known each other for many years. Raphael and I have known each other since we were 16, Robinson said in a 2019 interview with Firing Lives magazine. He used to play in my band in San Francisco. He would sit down in a chair and play bass because he was nervous. Standing in front of the audience was too much for me, so I would turn my back to the audience. Robinson said in an interview with Halftime Chat that Sadiq was sort of jealous of her because music entertainment writers wanted to interview her most of the time. Subsequently, Robinson accused Sadiq of not looking out for her financially. She said that she didn't really go over the contracts like she should have because of the level of trust she had in Sadiq. Robinson said when the Lucy Pearl album didn't come out, as she was led to believe, it negatively impacted her financial status, which had a ripple effect on her ability to pay house mortgage payments. We were supposed to have our album out by June. Here we are in November. Our album wasn't out, said Robinson. And I was like, Raphael, the bank has been calling me about my house. I'm going to lose my house. And I was telling him prior to that, I need money. According to Robinson, Sadiq said he would help, but in the end, he didn't come through for her. I ended up literally losing my house, said Robinson. Robinson also said she wanted to do a Lucy Pearl reunion, but added she would not do anything with Sadiq until he makes amends. Now, I don't know, man. That's kind
of... that sounds very crazy and everything. Like I said, how are you going to blame somebody for something that was going on within your yeah, I'm not liking this.
Like, Don, for real, what you do with the En Vogue money, yo?
Yeah, we haven't even gotten to that part. She's like,
remember, she left En Vogue. Remember, she left En Vogue. En Vogue didn't kick her out. She left. She left.
And we don't know the reason she left En Vogue either. So, like I said, there could have been some hanky-panky going on in that as well, and that might have been the reason that she left. I was actually, as you were finding interesting stories, I found one that's totally crazy, and I was just trying to figure out how people fall for the okey-doke. But again, I've fallen for the okey-doke as well on occasions. You know, sometimes you just get suckered into different things and everything. But I don't know that I'm going to believe somebody that has got magical powers. But apparently, that's what happened in this case of somebody that was accused of sex trafficking. I know that's a very serious crime and everything. But it says a Smithfield man convicted of killing a man in 2006 and accused of killing another has been convicted himself of sex trafficking. So this man, Mr. Jenkins, promised people food, shelter, and a better life, but he withheld food and their earnings. He beat and choked his victims, sometimes rendered them unconscious, according to federal prosecutors on a statement released earlier today. He told his victims that he had magical powers, and as they tried to escape, he would hunt them down and eliminate them. So he took advantage of them by claiming that he had magical powers. So I'm trying to figure out, would you actually believe somebody if they came to you and they told you they had magical powers if they were trying to hold you against your will and all of that? But that's apparently one of the things that he did was he told them that he had magical powers.
You know what? I don't know. I would, after I finished saying Frosted Lucky Charms, they're magically delicious 1,000 times and getting on that damn nerve, you know, I'd be like, since you got these magical powers, man, and you hold me against my will, I need some things. I like me all my bills paid off, you know what I mean? Since you got these magical powers, you can magically make my debt disappear. And let's see what else I need. You know, I need to live to be 150 years old. Like, since you got these powers, I need them. Like, I'm going to use you. Since you hold me against my will, you might as well grant my wishes. You know, everybody that I know that I've ever spoken to, shaking their hand, had a brief conversation, I need them to be debt-free and also find $250,000 in their bank accounts. You know what I mean? Like, since you have these magical powers, I'm going to start asking for some of the craziest stuff ever. You know what I'm saying? I need a lifetime supply of Oreo double-stuffed cookies. You know what I mean? Like, Wawa diet lemonades. I need gallons, jugs of those, and I need unlimited gas for my car. And when my car needs a tune-up and all that stuff, I should be able to trade it in for another model with no car payment, and I should never have to pay a bill again. If I go to a restaurant, it's already paid for in front of, you know, before, when I sit down, it's paid for, so I can get up, eat, and leave. Since you got magical powers, I'm just saying.
I agree with you. I think of all of that. By the way, I think you just came up with a masterful idea, so I'm going to repeat both of those things. Just, and if I say them wrong, just correct me and everything. But Wawa, if you are listening, and there was another thing that Dean said he loves a lot as well. If you are listening and you would like to be a sponsor of Straight Talk with Dean and Marc, we will not argue with you in the least bit. I'm sure Dean would enjoy you being a sponsor. So what were those items again that we want? Because I know that right now my friend Zach is trying to get Monster to sponsor his thing by doing placement within his streaming show. So we're going to do a product placement right now. So what were those items you wanted again?
It was two things. It was the Wawa Diet Lemonade. Believe it or not, it tastes just like the regular lemonade. It's actually real good, man. I had to switch up, you know, what I drink. So I had to let the Mountain Dews go, but I found these Wawa Diet Lemonades, and they're awesome. And the other thing, even though I probably shouldn't have it, I still love them, is Oreo Double Stuffed Cookies, man. So those are the two things that I said.
So Wawa and Oreo, if you are listening, neither Dean or Marc will argue with you sponsoring them, because I actually do like Oreos as well. So if you're listening and you want to sponsor us, we will not argue in the least bit. Just letting you know, we will not argue in the least bit whatsoever. Now, I am a little bit sad about something. As you will recall, at the time that we were with another show and everything, I was, and I might have even been there briefly during our tenure here and everything, but I was living in Raleigh with a young lady love and all of that at that time. That relationship did not work out, and they moved on, and I moved on, and all of that. But I would sometimes come back from Durham to go to Raleigh, where I was staying with that person, and I would sometimes stop at Snoopy's. Unfortunately, the Snoopy's is a small franchise, hot dog franchise, and it looks like yesterday was their last shop at that particular Snoopy's used to go to on Hillsboro. They said it's squeezed by development and the financial pressures of the COVID-19 pandemic. The Hillsboro Street Snoopy's, and they had several Snoopy's around the area and everything, but this was the last one near Glenwood Avenue. And I remember that one because that's the one I would stop at. The owners announced on Facebook that the Snoopy's location at 600 Hillsboro Street in Raleigh sold its last hot dog on Sunday. So as one that several of those hot dogs while waiting for my lady friend to come in and pick me up and everything, I definitely am not glad to see that particular Snoopy's closing and all of that. So it says that while not the first Snoopy's to open in Raleigh, the 600 Hillsboro Street location was one of the most recognizable, becoming a lunchtime and late night fixture. And of course, if I'm coming back from Asia, that's when I was going there, was late night, and thriving as an Eastern North Carolina roadside hot dog stand in the middle of the capital city. It was also the Snoopy's location closest to downtown, standing near another beloved Raleigh institution, Chargill. So definitely they opened in Raleigh in 1978 and later added the Hillsboro Street location in 1990. They had three other locations that remained open, including the original. Three other Snoopy's locations remain open, including the original at the corner of Wake Forest and Whitaker, another location further west on Hillsboro Street near Meredith, and in North Raleigh on Spring Forest. So I can still go there and possibly get some Snoopy's, but it will not be that one that was a fixture in my life and everything, at least there. Okay, you know, sometimes it's a sad when your fixtures disappear and all of that.
Right, because you're so used to stopping by there, even if you don't go there every day, you know, you know where it is, and that's like when I go home, you know, to visit, there's a place called, and it's pronounced, if you look at it, it says, What a Burger. Now, those of us from home in Virginia, we don't say it like that. We say What a Burger. Some people say What a Burger, you know, and we know what it is, though. And it's like, the burgers that come straight off the grill, man, with mustard, onions, lettuce, tomato, you know, mayonnaise if you want it. But the food is awesome. And they used to be in this little small building on Washington Street in my hometown, Petersburg, Virginia, man. And there was nowhere to go in. It was like a walk-up window. And you just kind of stood by the window. You could see inside of it. It was the counter right there where they took your order. And right behind it was like the grill. And then you could see a part in the back where they probably had the refrigerator or whatever. So you were watching them fix your food there. All you just got to do is look through the window. But the food, you know, they put it in the white paper, wrap it up. Awesome, man. Fries, you know, burgers, milkshakes. They had everything that you needed was right there. We would get there, stand. If it's raining, go sit in your car. You know what I'm saying? But then they'll let you know when your food's up. Get your food, and you'll definitely be full. So they moved into a restaurant further down Washington Street. So now you can actually go in, sit down and eat, you know, and the food is still good. You know what I mean? So, in fact, the I don't know if you saw what's the movie? It's about the dude's pledge in the fraternity. And it was shot down there in my hometown. And the restaurant, the drive-thru they were at was the drive-thru for the Whataburger. In fact, they don't have you know, how the new signs are all digital and everything. They still got the old-school signs with the letters that you stick inside of there. So you had to open the case and change the letters if you change the name or something. And, you know, when you see those marquees now, you know the food is hidden.
Oh, yeah.
You know, those yep. new those and new signs are new ways of doing it. Those are the old school sign, man. They still doing the old school.
No, I remember those old school ways. There was a place, there was like a burger joint like that in my hometown of Warrington, and I think it's still open. I think I was talking to one of my schoolmates, and they told me that it's still open, but it was definitely the popular place that everybody went to. If it's not open, it's only recently closed and everything, but definitely I know a lot of folks would go there, and they would get the fancy burgers that they made that were almost like homemade and all of that. So definitely I'm a big fan of those kind of spots that have got a little bit of that home taste and all of that. So, and I just saw that another one that closed here in Durham as well, and that's actually part of a shopping district that we have called Brightleaf, but they're one of the popular restaurants there, a popular Mexican restaurant. It's part of a chain, the El Rodeo chain, but that particular El Rodeo had shut down after having been part of that shopping district for 32 years. So they shut down last week. Looks like the article was written on the 22nd, but they are looking at possibly moving, but they definitely said it will be closing next month. So they'll be closing this month of March in search of a new location. So they've been around for 32 years at that same location, and a lot of folks have gotten used to them as well. If you wanted good Mexican food, you would go there, and there were some other places. I think Torero's was nearby as well, but definitely a lot of the impact of what we're seeing with the coronavirus is its impact on our restaurants. So the restaurants have definitely been heavily impacted, and I had heard some prediction that there could be a whole lot of them closing down over the next several years. We know that several have already closed down. I'm sure even in your neighborhood of New Jersey, you've seen some of your favorites that are no longer around because folks are either doing DoorDash or Grubhub, or they're not getting enough business support. So definitely I feel for our restaurant owners around the country, because these are very difficult times for them, just like they are for everybody else. So are there any favorites of yours that you've seen disappearing out of New Jersey? You mentioned the one from back home, but are there any that you're seeing disappearing out of New Jersey?
Not right offhand, because Red Robin is still open, and you know, they have limited inside seating with the social distancing and everything, but they're doing, you know, they're still open. There's a place called Supremo's Pizzeria. You know, they're getting a lot of DoorDash and Uber Eats orders and stuff like that. And then there's another place called Pizza Wings Steaks and Things, and they have some awesome cheese steaks, man. And they stay busy. So, you know, you can walk in, you call in your order, you walk, pick it up. They could deliver it to you. You can do DoorDash, Grubhub. You know, so they stay busy, because I stopped by there one day a couple of weeks ago, and it was like 12 noon, and just the in and out. They stay busy.
Wow. Well, that's good. And there's some restaurants even around here like Firehouse and Enzo's and Chipotle that seem to be staying busy around the Duke campus and everything. But there, that Brightleaf area was really hit hard, because the article that I was reading, the rest of it says that El Rodeo's departure is following years of closing restaurants in Brightleaf, including popular Duke Hangout Satisfaction. And yeah, it was a very popular hangout. It was kind of like a pizza joint, but they also had burgers and then, of course, plenty of liquid refreshment. And Duke students used to go there on a regular basis. Italian restaurant, Trattero Salve, Fondue restaurant, the Little Dipper, and Mount Fuji's Japanese restaurant. And then a major retail shop, Morgan Imports, had closed, and Parker and Otis, which is kind of like a another kind of, not so much of a gift shop. That's what Morgan Imports was, more of like what I would consider that. Parker's and Otis was almost like a, kind of almost like a type of grocery store, and they've moved locations. So definitely we're seeing big impacts around the country with this coronavirus, and hopefully we're going to get this herd immunity and folks can get better and all of that. But it looks like we're almost winding down. We actually might have a whole 2-hour conversation among me and Dean and all of that, with some musical interlude and all of that. But we had our mysterious caller that disappeared and did not show up. And I'll have to call and see if that's who I thought it was going to be, because I did invite at least one person, because I try to book for all the different shows that I'm involved with and everything. So I know I had booked somebody for us, but I think I had booked two people. So I've got to do some research and find out what happened to them, and, of course, find us some more amazing guests. But if folks are listening, been hearing our conversations about restaurants and about a number of other things that we've been talking about and would like to be on the show. We love having guests from a variety of communities. So you can reach me at bluesradio@gmail.com. Dean, you want to tell them where they can reach you if they want to reach out to you? Because sometimes people like to talk to you more than they want to talk to me, even though I think we both got great personalities.
Yeah, you know what? If you want to reach out to me, I can be reached at 807, the number's 807 media, M-E-D-I-A, at gmail.com.
Sounds great. So, yeah, you can reach out to us both that way and everything. And definitely we'll try to book some more amazing guests. We're always glad to have great conversations. But every once in a while, it just becomes like chit-chat between me and Dean, just because that's the way the cookies crumble, as the old saying goes, and all of that. But we still have fun. We still kick it. We still enjoy our conversations. And we still hope that you're enjoying the conversations that we bring to you as we give you some of our thoughts, some of the things that are on our minds, and things of that nature. I know one of the things that's on Dean's mind is trying to figure out who his team is going to pick to enhance his already superpower team. So I don't think the draft has been held. Do you have any idea who you want to? Do you have any idea who you want them to pick?
Somebody who can come in and contribute. You know, we don't need. And it's funny because, you know, when you look at drafts and stuff like that, you never can tell who is going to do what. Just because they excelled on the collegiate level doesn't automatically equate to success on a professional level. So, you know, somebody that could come in, man, and we got to be able to balance that offense out, you know, not be too run heavy, but not be overly dependent on the pass. And when we're able to do those things, then we can make another trip to the Super Bowl and hopefully grab that third trophy. So, you know, it's about time. And you know, that way the Lamar Jackson critics can go ahead and relax a little bit, you know.
Yep, they can definitely relax. I thought he's done a great job. I might even try to pick him up in the next fantasy draft, because that'll be coming up sometime in the summer or the fall, so I might have to pick him up. I'm always getting your defense, and they always usually give me some great points, so I might pick them up again this year. So we'll see whether I can still grab them or whether other people are realizing they're powerhouses and want to grab them from me. But I'm always glad to get some Baltimore players. We won't tell my friend Bill Trezvant that you don't think that his Jets are going to do anything, because right now he's thinking that his Jets are going to be the next superpower along with your team and along with the other teams that might have made it into the Super Bowl and all of that. But he's thinking that his Jets are going to do really well now that they've got a new coach and all of that, and he's a diehard Jets fan, so we might have to have him. He called in the show before, so we might have to have Mr. Even though he's from Buffalo, Mr. Buffalo. Oh, that's right. I'm sorry. I'm getting people mixed up. But we might have to have Mr. Buffalo Bill, which is actually the team that Bill belongs to, talk to Mr. Zach and have Zach call in. Zach is the one who thinks that the New York Jets are going to do really well and all of that. So some of your rivals are feeling that their teams will still be able to handle y'all, including one that hasn't been able to handle y'all forever. So I don't know what Zach is seeing in those Jets, but he's thinking that the Jets are going to do something.
Hey, man, there's nothing wrong with having confidence in your team. You know what I mean? I look at it like, you know, I'm a part of the Ravens Nation, so that's what my heart is, right there in Baltimore.
Got to be part of that Ravens Nation. I can understand. I have never set my foot a day in my life in Minnesota, but I am a diehard Vikings fan. They torture me every year, and I'm still going to be a diehard Vikings fan until one of these days they make it back to the Super Bowl and maybe actually win it. But like I said, once you're a diehard fan, and I hope it happens in my lifetime, I'm like you. You stay a diehard fan, so I'm a diehard Vikings fan waiting for them to make some changes so that we can actually do something. Because there have been times we've had ingredients and haven't been able to quite put the pieces together. So maybe this will be the year that we can put some pieces together and at least make a run against them Packers and some of the other teams that have done much better than us, and maybe even make a run into the playoffs heading in to the Super Bowl, because it's been a number of years since we've done that. Or we can be like my baseball team, the Milwaukee Brewers, that love to either make a run and not do anything, or choke in the middle and still not do anything. So, like I said, they've just been really torturing me because, like I said, I remember one year looked like they were jumping way out ahead of everybody, and then they just kind of like choked and faded into the sunset. And another time, it looked like they were going to make a run and made it into the playoffs, and then didn't do anything in the playoffs. So some of these teams of ours can really frustrate us, but that doesn't mean anything because I, like you, am a diehard fan. So I will stick with my Golden Eagles, who are also not having a good year, even though they did come to Carolina and upset UNC with a losing record. So, like I said, you know, sometimes people pick up a team because they say, hell, that team ain't doing nothing, and we need a pickup game. So they picked up Marquette, but Marquette carried some of that Big East pride and came down here and said, y'all can't just kick us because we got a losing record and think that we're not going to give y'all at least a run for your money. So, like I said, they come down here and defeated Carolina, and Carolina's like, maybe we shouldn't have picked that team. Maybe we should have picked somebody else. So sometimes, you know, you pick somebody because you think it's going to do something for you, and it does the opposite. So we'll see how that all plays out in the NCAA tournament bids when they come out in the month of March as they head into March Madness and all of that. So it'll be interesting to see how it all plays out. But like I said, I'm going to stick with my teams just like you're going to stick with yours. So I'm a Milwaukee Brewers, a Minnesota Vikings, and definitely a Golden Eagle out of my Midwestern teams. And, of course, I got to root for my Durham Bulls and a couple of other teams as well. And, of course, I am hoping that Doc is doing well with and will continue to do well with those Philadelphia 76ers. So definitely have some teams that I'm rooting for also. So if you want to tell folks about our great network, the Next Level, and what we've got on tap, and then, of course, where they can hear this replay of our rants and conversation. But that's kind of what we had today.
Well, I sure can do that, y'all. Straight Talk with Dean and Marc, Monday night, 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Don't forget to check our replays on the Skyhawk Radio Network tomorrow afternoon and Wednesday afternoon at 2 p.m. And if you miss those, we have replays on Radio Public, iHeartRadio, Google Podcasts, Spotify, Spreaker, TuneIn, Stitcher, Podbean, Apple Podcasts, Podchaser, Podcast Addict, CastBox, PodFollow, Deezer, Jay Savin, and right here on Blog Talk Radio, where we are a part of the Level Podcast Network, where you can catch other shows in addition to ours, such as the Black Girl's Guide to Surviving Menopause, Chef Gang Radio Show, Funk from the Front Seat, Funk Music with Zach, Learning Unwrapped, Let's K-12 Better, Marketing with Russ, hashtag aka Russ Selfie, Mona Shake and the Minority Reports, Mullings Music and Memories with Marc Lee, The Online Dinner Party with Marc Lee, The Plant a Good Seed Podcast, The Reinvention Road Trip, She's on Call, The Just Podcast, The Marc Lee Show, The Spin It Social Hour, Virginia Interfaith Live, and WNC Original Music. Now, like I always say, when you walk outside your front door, showtime, and the world is your stage. Just make sure that people are not watching the rehearsal. With that being said, it's the six-man Dean Geronimo. Have an outstanding week. And as always, we see y'all 7 days.
See him in 7 days, hopefully with some more amazing guests and all of that. So we're looking forward to some more engaging conversations. We will see y'all in 7 days. And who knows, I might even invite Eric to share his reflections about that amazing conference that he had going on this past week. I know today he was trying to take a day off because he had 7 days worth of work in terms of doing that conference and other things, but he can't really talk to me because he also gave me a contract for that other conference that was going on, which meant, Dean, I did 15 days of a streaming podcast work. So I needed to take me a break from like doing the production of podcasts and everything of that nature, well, in terms of festival conferences, because I did 15 days of conferences. One conference that lasted for 8 days and the other conference that lasted for 7. Last time I checked, that equals 15 days straight.
You're right. So it's time to get some rest, man. We'll see y'all next week.
See you then.